Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. We all have moments in our lives where we suddenly say, where is God? What do I believe? Why isn't someone helping me? Well, there's also the other part of saying, thank you, God. Well, there is a book that my guest, Victoria Sackheim, has put together, edited, called Faith. It's a noun, faith. And the essays from believers, agnostics, and atheists. The book is published by Beyond Words, Simon & Schuster. Welcome, Victoria.
Thank you very much.
And truly, faith is one of those things where you sort of say, what do I really believe? What do I feel? And how can I get through this?
It's true, and it's interesting because when I put the invitation out to 25 authors to write about it, I expected maybe 10 of them to say yes, and 23 of them came back immediately and said they wanted to do it. And then the confusion started. Well, what do you want me to write about? I want you to write about what you believe. Well, what do you mean, what do I believe? This is about faith. It doesn't have to be about religion, but what do you believe? And it was an interesting process for everybody because it didn't come easily.
Well, I love the fact Ann Perry says, when she thinks of faith, she hears her father's voice in her head.
Yes.
And when she thinks of faith, she thinks of her grandfather's voice in her heart.
Yes.
Talk a little bit about her essay.
Her essay was, first of all, it's the first essay she's ever written and the first anthology for her. So it was a fascinating experience. And also to edit her, to go back and say, you talk about when you are alone at 3 a.m, when you are feeling alone, and to come back and say to her, Anne, the personal essay is about you. When I am alone, when I am feeling afraid. And she said, okay, I can do that. And the revisions were very simple with her. But Anne has a profound belief. She's a Mormon. She follows the faith very, very closely. But she's also a feminist. So she's found a place for herself in that religion. But she believes very strongly. And she and Mara Pearl are two of the authors in the book who have both told me that they would give up their careers before they'd give up their faith.
Who is the one who went to the psychic mother, Mira?
That was Barbara Graham. And it's a wonderful essay because she's done a few readings and the audience has just loved it. But she talks about going to the small town in Germany, of all places, where Mengele did some of his experimentation, as a young Jewish woman, going to this Indian woman who's this Mother Mira, who's supposed to help her become enlightened.
Well, and she takes your head into her hands, Mother Mira, and supposedly holds it for 30 seconds, and then everything happens. Well, with Barbara, she looked at her after the and said, oof, and go.
And sent her away.
Yeah.
And Barbara felt rejected. She felt as if she hadn't lived up to whatever it was, that expectation. And then it finally hit her that what she had to learn was to trust herself.
Yeah.
To get it from within herself, not to keep looking out and out and out.
How long a time did she spend with this woman?
Oh, I think totally probably 2 minutes.
Yeah. Over a week.
Yes.
Oh.
In the room with a lot of people, but in terms of approaching her and having this woman confront her or deal with her face-to-face, very, very short time.
How many of these writers have been through ashrams and other areas where one would say, really?
I would guess of the 23 writers, maybe two. I know that Beverly D'Onofrio had lived not in a convent, but in a monastery for quite a few years at the top of the mountains in Colorado. And now she's in San Miguel de Allende, I think she's in on the East Coast now. But you had mentioned to her before that she had written a profound essay about a serial rapist getting into her home and attacking her. And before when he began to attack her a second time, she began to pray.
And I'm going to ask you to read that, if you will.
Yes.
What had she written prior to this?
Well, she's been in quite a few of my anthologies. She's a wonderful writer. But she wrote a memoir called Riding in Cars with Boys that became a film, and a very good film. And so here's what she says. This is precisely when a serial rapist slips into my bed. "Don't scream. I have a knife," he says, in such a tone you'd think he's bored, as though he's used it many times before, which he actually has. I will be his fifth known victim in 8 months. People in town have mail-ordered mace and made their own pepper spray. They've installed bars on windows, put their houses up for sale, fled because of this man. I know from the experiences of other victims, two of whom I'm friendly with, that if I fight, I'll get beat up. If I don't fight, I won't. So I cross my arms on my chest, turn my face away, and the physical attack is over in 2 minutes. Afterward, he wants to talk, as I'd heard he would, in a sick perversion of post-coital intimacy before he rouses himself for another round. Like a prisoner hearing his buddy being tortured in the next cell, I dread the rest of the evening. I decide to check out and pray. I begin a Hail Mary, then in seconds it occurs to me to pray out loud and maybe freak the rapist out. "You're praying," he barks, pounding my shoulder with his fist. "Stop praying." "I'm praying for you," I bark back, which is a lie I realize I should make the truth. And so I pray for him, which helps me remember to pray for myself. As I pray the Hail Mary out loud, inside I beg Mary, God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, every dead relative, angel, and saint to get this man the hell out of my bed and out of my house. He backs out of the bed, pats my shoulder, says, "It's okay, I'm leaving," and lets himself out.
I read that, and I mean, it's one of those, you stop and you think of what this woman has been tortured with.
Yes. Yeah. And not only that, but she wrote about it. And because she wrote about it and it was in the local paper, he attacked another woman who began to pray immediately, and he took off before he had a chance to rape her.
Did they ever catch him?
I believe they did. I believe they did. I'd have to read that again, but I think that he did. He was caught eventually.
Now, there's also someone who has, was interesting. She goes, she's from Argentina, and she goes to France and marries a French man who was of Jewish descent.
Yes.
She is had become in Argentina Protestant Episcopal for her family.
Yes, Susanna Franck.
And now they have two daughters, and the daughters living in France, going to school with the other little girls. They want to become Catholics.
Yes.
And what they go through to because families aren't totally approving, they're wondering why. And then later, they have a religious marriage ceremony, not just in the civic center.
Yes. Yes. Susanna is, she's a remarkable woman. She's actually a woman who does a lot of brain research, and she's involved in cognition.
Susanna Franck.
Susanna Franck. And she's come through this through many, many years of searching and then not paying attention and then searching again and not paying attention. And it wasn't until she became very ill a few years ago that she realized that she wanted to do it a different way. She wanted a religious service of marriage.
Mm-hmm.
And it became extraordinarily important to her. And her husband, Guillaume, who adores her, his attitude was, if this is what you want, this is what we'll do. I mean, he was just happy that she was alive.
Yeah.
And so they went through the ceremony.
Interesting story.
Yes.
Yeah, the dynamics. Now we come to one whose dynamics are so wonderful and great, Pam Houston.
Yes.
Whose titles, If There Is a God, Why Would He, She Waste All Her Time Making Hell?
Well, you know, I mean, you know Pam. Yeah. Pam has a wonderful wit. She has a way of writing that just pulls you in. Yeah. Whether you agree with her or not, you're beguiled by the way she puts her words together. And I really enjoyed reading this essay. Of course, every time the authors would send the essay to me, I had this process where I would print it out, make my mug of tea, sit on the couch, and read it, and promise myself I wouldn't do any edits until I read the whole thing through. And with Pam's, I got so involved in it that I had to go back and read it three or four times before I actually started editing.
Yeah.
Because I kept getting caught up in the story of one amazing thing after another that was happening while she was just taking a walk on the beach.
Yeah. Oh, finding her key. I mean, this is...
Yes.
You have... She's got a rental car. She's got a thing that goes around the neck, but she doesn't take it with her from the car. And as she walks the beach, the tide is coming in,
yes,
and the waves are coming up, and yet she's going to face the future walking that beach, including seeing some man lying naked in a chair, and all the parts of what goes on. And then She goes to try to find the key, and it's not there. Now she goes back to the car, and it's not there. I mean, anyone who has had this feeling, and it's getting darker out.
That's right.
She finds the key.
She actually backtracks and looks at areas where the tide has already come in and washed things out, and there is the key sitting there.
Well, I mean, tell me you don't believe in extrasensory.
Yes. Whatever. Yes, that sort of thing absolutely makes you believe. Yeah. Yes.
Amy Ferris.
Amy is an extraordinary writer. Her memoir, Marrying George Clooney, was made into a very good play. And she writes, Amy has a way of writing where she makes fun of herself in a sense. She mm-hmm. pulls off all the facades that people try to build up to protect themselves. And her way of writing, even on Facebook, she just puts it right out there. And one day she thought, I'm bored, I need something. Oh, I think I need a child. And she says to her husband, Ken, I think we need a child. He said, okay, well, I'm watching the football game. You go get a child. And she goes to social services and has this experience with this woman with the very bad hairdo. But what she realizes is that she's thinking of almost like renting a child. What she really wants is to fill a very empty place inside of her. And it's not a child that will do it. It's her own life.
Which is a very poignant way of ending it. And then she said, I wanted to tell this woman, get a better haircut.
That's right. Yeah. That's right.
But the woman, after being very frosty to her, does open up.
She more than opens up. She becomes emotional.
Yeah.
Because Amy is like that. Amy's this loving, loving woman, and you can't help but to share that when you meet her. It's a very important part of who she is. So she might say, you know, I love you, I love you, and she might tell 50 people in the same day, but she means it.
Yeah, but then where does the word faith come in an essay like that?
I think that Amy was out searching for something, which many of us do when we're wondering about what we believe. Mm-hmm. And she realized finally that the faith that she had was in herself.
Yeah.
And I don't think she talks very much about faith in God, whether she believes or not. Mm-hmm. But what she does talk about is she has to trust herself, and that is her faith.
The man who is a rabbi in England.
Frank Dabba Smith.
Well, tell me about the word Dabba. I've never...
Dabba?
Yeah.
Well, actually, I happen to know because Frank's a dear friend. Dabba was the last name of his father's dear friend. And so when Frank was born, his father honored this friend by naming him Frank Dabba Smith.
I wondered if it had, you know, a religious connotation.
No, not at all.
No.
Not at all.
Tell me about him.
Well, Frank is a Californian. He grew up in San Diego, went to Cal, was a phenomenal photographer, became the official photographer at Berkeley, and then went to Israel. And I met him when he had just finished Cal, when I was dating his rabbi, actually.
Oh.
And that was such a long time ago. And he went to Israel, fell in love, married a Brit, moved back to London, and called me one day and said, I'm going to go into a whole new part of my life. And I said, wonderful, whatever you want to do, you can do. He said, well, I love education, I love Judaism, I love people, I'm going to apply to rabbinic school.
Yeah.
And he said, would you be one of the people who writes a letter of recommendation? I said, I'd be thrilled. Yeah. And I did, and he got in. And then when it came time for him to be ordained, the school said to all of the rabbinic students, you may have one person who presents you. His family was there, his parents were there, and I was the one who got to present him.
Oh,
it was,
Victoria, that's very touching.
Yes, and so he's been a rabbi for many years now, and he's very involved in the eco movement, the ecology movement between the Jews, Muslims, and Christians in Jordan, Palestine, and the UK. And he writes about this in his essay, and how he's brought his children into this movement as well. And of course, even though they're trying to make more water in areas and bring back lakes that have died, it's also a way for him to say to his children, these are the Muslims, these are the Christians, these are the Jews, we're all working together, which we should be doing.
Yeah. Which, when you consider to all of those sects, this is the Holy Land.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And the Abrahamic religions are all there.
Yeah.
And they're all hurting each other in the name of God.
True. I felt very badly for the woman whose husband died, and you did donate or dedicate a page to him.
Leon Whiteson was a wonderful writer, a fierce, fierce writer, and a dear, dear friend. And he's been in several of my anthologies, and he came up with the idea of what he wanted to write, and then he died. He really fought hard against his cancer, and it just took over. But Aviva has been in, I think, almost all of my anthologies, and in fact, her essay in my first one, The Other Woman, is part of the play that we're doing in November.
Oh, really?
We're doing a simultaneous reading at dozens and dozens of theaters around the country on the same night. So if there are 100 theaters, there'll be 500 women seated on a stage acting.
Yeah.
And hers is one of them. And
you've done a lot of unique things, Victoria. What was the basis for that in your life growing up?
You know, it's interesting, Connie, because when I turned 60, I made a promise to myself that if I had a creative idea, I wasn't going to say, oh, that would have been wonderful. I was going to try it out and see what I could do with it. And so in the last, I just turned 70, so in the last 10 years, thank you, as Barbara Abercrombie says, I am now 70, which sounds a lot better than 70. But I've done all the anthologies in the last 10 years. I've done two plays. I have two films that are in development now, screenplays, and I'm just having a wonderful time, a wonderful time. I don't know if I can sustain the energy level, but I'm giving it a heck of a try.
David Mitch.
Oh, he's wonderful.
Yeah.
David Mitch is a wonderful writer and a delightful man. I think you might have interviewed
him. Yes,
you
interviewed? I have. Yeah.
And he came the other night for our reading, and of course the audience loved him.
Yeah.
And he starts off with a joke, and he ends up with a joke. It's not, and his joke in there, of course, is knock, knock, who's there, God? God who? Oh, no, not another atheist.
Yeah.
And he's wonderful, but he talks about the history of humor and religion.
Yeah.
And he looks at it through a pragmatic way, but also through the eyes of a comedy writer who wrote Mork and Mindy and Saturday Night Live and is just a very clever and delightful man.
But basically, what does he believe? What does he feel?
It's difficult sometimes to determine that when you're reading his essay because he comes through several different viewpoints.
Yeah.
But my feeling is, I mean, you know, he instead of calling his essay the faith word, he calls it the F word.
Yeah.
And he talks about the fact that he has to look into himself occasionally, but I think what he believes really is what a few of the authors believe, which is that international, global, universal feeling of people working together and in that harmony and what we do or don't do to make it work.
There was also where you've talked about we've all lost someone. And I'd love to have you read a couple of those paragraphs. That is you.
Did I write this? Yes, I did.
Yes, you did.
We've all lost someone we loved. Whenever I've been faced with grief and the challenge of accepting loss, I've thought of friends whose faith supports and comforts. Although I feel a profound faith in the potential goodness of humanity, I often wish I could add to that an equally profound faith in God. The idea of never feeling alone is so powerful, and those who believe in God share that nurturing conviction. I not only envy them, I hope to perhaps one day join them, but my journey is just beginning, and I'm still at that place where I'm asking myself, will I ever believe in something with such certainty that it would sustain me not only through moments of loss and despair, but through the everyday tableau of life? This is the question that forms in my brain and then tightens my chest, wrapping itself around my heart, refusing to release its hold. And yet, as I type the question, I have to smile, because while I struggle with the very concept of God, I've always been driven by an abiding belief, an abiding faith in life and in the goodness of humanity. My glass is always half full, if not completely full, and I've enjoyed a lifelong optimism reminding me that goodwill will always conquer evil.
Thank you. What were your parents like?
My parents were the children of Eastern European Jews. My father's parents were communists, and they called them communists here, they called them socialists here, who did not believe in God. My grandfather, whom I never met, he was killed before I was born, was from a place in Eastern Europe called Nový Dvor, outside of Warsaw. And there were 38 members of his family there during World War II, and one of them survived.
Yeah.
So that had a profound effect on me. My mother's parents were also very left-wing, and her father was a Zionist and then turned his back on it, essentially, and came to the United States. And he was a scholar. He was a Yiddish scholar who taught in many languages. And my mother, in fact, spoke Russian until she went to public school, even though she was born in the States.
Were you an only child?
No, I have an older sister.
Uh-huh.
And Michelle is also a writer, and she has published quite a few books. And she has a play, in fact, that she's doing, I think, the week after next with Vanessa Redgrave in New York.
That's an interesting combination.
Yes, yes.
Vanessa is well known as being anti-Israel, mm-hmm. and probably all the ramifications from that.
Yes. But my sister is, the play is based on her last novel, The Last Train to Paris, and about a Jewish woman and what happens with her in her life as a journalist. So, and she's a longtime friend with Vanessa, so I think that they have collaborated on this, and it probably will be a wonderful event.
Well, should be very interesting.
Very, very.
Yes. Malachi McCourt.
The irrepressible Mr.
Yes.
McCourt? You know, I think that one of my favorite essays ever was In Exit Laughing, when he wrote about what really happened to Angela's ashes.
Yeah.
And taking them on a plane that suddenly had to turn back because it had engine failure, and holding up a can of peas, saying, "Would you like to meet my mother?"
Yeah.
And deciding that people probably didn't want to see a dead person when they thought they were about to die.
Yeah.
But in this book, in the Faith book, he writes a rant against organized religion.
Mm-hmm.
And he calls it a rant, and it really, really is.
Yeah.
And it came to a point where I said, "You know, Malachi, we might have to tone this down just a little bit." And he said, "You do whatever you want." And I said, "Well, I'll pass it by you to make sure that you approve it." He said, no, if just make it work so that it works in the book." But that's not what I did. So I sent it back to him and said, "Okay, read it and let me know." And he said, "Yeah, this works. Yeah. I kind of like this word in there, that word in there." And so it's there.
Did you ever get a chance to see him and his brother doing two black arts, I think they called themselves?
Oh, I didn't see it. I didn't see it. But I do have an idea for another anthology, and I ran it by him, and he said, and Frank, of course, is gone, but he said, "Oh, my brother and I will do it."
Yeah.
So we'll see. We'll see.
Well, probably it's the voice in his head saying that.
He's an amazing man. And he I'll see him next week. He's coming to the reading. He's reading with me in New York.
Well, please say hello to
him. I will.
For
me. I certainly will.
And you mentioned the last page of the book.
It's Amanda Enoyati's.
And I'm going to let you.
Thank you.
Read it.
Let me go back to this. Let me give you a very brief overview, in that Amanda and her family are Baha'i, and they were forced to leave Iran after the fall of the Shah. So she writes about that, and about the isolation that she felt, and how difficult it was. And she now writes for CNN. "I want to tell you about a miracle. You're free to accept it as true or as a good story. It is the tale of a young girl, a child of faith, turned out from her home for no good reason, separated from her kin, tormented for decades by what life delivered at her doorstep, a virtual encyclopedia of tragedy, revolution, disease, isolation, dysfunction, terrorism, failure, and withdrawal. You also ought to know that if you were to meet this girl, you might think that a sunnier person never lived. Eventually, she grew numb, this girl, extinguished and faithless, consumed again and again by the fires that threatened to destroy her, until she realized that they didn't. They did not and had not destroyed her. The devil researed, yes, but the burn, the agony, the pain had only made her stronger, more powerful. She looked inward and saw that beneath those wounds, she burned bright like a dozen suns. She burned with wrath, with fury. She burned with justice and compassion and love, and she burned once again with faith. And then she took flight. She realized as she flew that her powers and blessings had grown in proportion to her faith, that her faith had solidified through the suffering, and that this had been her balance all along."
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And will you sign my book, Victoria?
I am honored.
How wonderful. I mean, your range has been astonishing.
Thank you. It's been fun.
If you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web and ConnieMartinson.com. Go to YouTube. You'll be able to see this program again or recommend it to friends. But support your local library. It is our finest, really finest democratic institution in America. You could be polka dot and you're still welcome into the library today. There was a time when it wasn't so easy. But today, thank heaven, we have a democratic library, including helping children learn to read better, helping old people learn to read better because their eyesight is giving out and they need bigger, really bigger print. And that's the way it helps them. But above all of that, it's the institution of a place where people can go, take out a book, return it in the condition it was in when they took it out and in time. Plus, libraries here in America, in Los Angeles, we have shows almost. Writers come and they read to the audience or talk to the audience. I know you've been doing that, haven't you, Victoria?
Yes, I love libraries and I do a lot of readings at libraries. Yeah. And in fact, I just came back from the Tucson Festival of Books and the money that they bring in goes for the literacy programs through the libraries.
Bravo. That's,
yes, absolutely.
We're doing the same here in Brentwood at the Brentwood Kaufman Library. They're doing it downtown at the main library. It's important. Donate what you don't need, especially if you have books you've read and you think maybe the store in the library can sell it. It's important. But just some of the things we feel about a library.
And join the Friends of the Library.
Well, that's the that's the group, the Friends of the Library, and they truly are friends.
Yes.
And Victoria,
thank you.
Come
it's a
again
pleasure,
anytime.